Good morning, once again. We will start now with the second panel, or with the first real panel after this keynote address of Professor Elisabeth Traube before the break. And we have three speakers. Each of them will talk about change. That's what I already inferred from the titles and from the abstracts, and also the value which is given to those change of to the old and to the new. But I will not anticipate.
Thank you very much. Then I will invite now the
thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Ricardo, for your invitation. This paper addresses a colonial controversy about marriage exchanges in the 1970s Dili. Retrospectively called a Guerra do Barlaque, this controversy has been considered a foundational event of East Timorese nationalism as it brought to the fore opposing oppositions about the local sociality and the ways this sociality should be respected or managed before a civilizational proposals. Not by chance, the acknowledgement of the marriage exchanges as the most iconic institution of the local sociality was at stake, and their meanings and effects were considered condensed manifestations of the character of the East Timorese people. According to Abido Araújo, the public debate on the issue in the 1970s was the basis for the emergence of the Mulberry as the political symbol of national pride and independence in East Timor, because the controversy provoked Ili people to develop, for the first time, a systematic and positive approach to local institutions. The fact that people like Abido Araújo, Nicolau Lobato, and Xavier do Amaral were protagonists in this controversy also gives these events a special flavor, since they came to be leading figures in the East Timorese nationalism. I assume that colonial discourses were government devices whereby certain realities were produced in order to give legitimacy to government practices. In Austin terms, these colonial discourses, through repetition and claims of authority, held a perlocutionary potential to create a reality that it appeared merely to describe. In other words, these discourses are in themselves political realities from which power effects are produced. In this perspective, the correlation between the agents' positions of power and the discourses about marriage exchange they held were not at all casual. Thus, it is not a coincidence that this controversy is understood today as a critical event in the emergence of the East Timorese nationalism. I argue that the attempts to inscribe the Barlaque in the market or in the gift regimes of exchange were a sort of epistemological project from which derived particular images of East Timorese peoples and their society in colonial Dili, as these attempts appeared in the Guerra do Barlaque. By comparison, the post-colonial debate about marriage exchange lacks its novelty, as it seems to be fostered by the same epistemological anxiety. In addition, I contend that these controversies were critical events by which the complexity of marriage exchanges in East Timor had been reduced to Barlaque or Rafoning in the Dili public space. This paper is divided in three main sections. In the first, I present the generative themes around which the controversies are focused. I also correlate what I propose to be called purifying and anti-purifying perspectives about marriage exchanges with the production of various discourses about indigenous people in East Timor. In this process, the association of marriage exchanges to various regimes of exchange seems to have a pivotal role in devising particular images of East Timorese indigenous people and their sociality. In the second section, the epistemological practices for legitimizing the opposing perspectives about marriage exchanges are discussed. The resorts to colonial ethnographies, etymological arguments, and methodological procedures are pointed out as the tactics used by people in the debate to support their perspectives. In the concluding remarks, the relations of continuity in the colonial and post-colonial debates about the Barlaki are highlighted, having as a backdrop research about marriage exchanges in contemporary. Before proceeding, I would like to stress that this is a work in progress. I have still not been able to gain access to all the primary sources produced in the debate, as the important article of Nicolau Lobato published at Seara. So I now go to the first part of the paper, the politics of knowledge in the 7th city. The Balak War was triggered out by two literary works by Inácio de Moura, the poem Mulher de Lipa, Feto Timor, and the short novel Mal Puro e Mal Velho, ou O Grande Amor de Caibut, published in 1969 and 1973, respectively. The controversy was presented in three main different publications: the colonial newspaper A Voz de Timor, the military bulletin A Província de Timor, and FCR, the Dili Diocese Magazine. The controversy was structured in two main positions backed by social actors with distinct origin in colonial view. On one hand was Inácio de Moura and Jaime Neves, who published in the colonial newspaper A Voz de Timor and who supported the idea that customary marriage in Timor, which they call Rafoli or Barlaki, was a market operation by which women were sold. On the other hand, were some educated and assimilated Istimorese interlocutors like Abel Araújo, Nicolau Lobato, and Xavier do Amaral, who claimed a broader approach to this institution and contended that it wasn't a commoditization device, but a complex and long-term phenomenon by which the reproduction of Istimorese societies came about. At first glance, it would be tempting to portray the controversy as one framed by an opposition between colonizer and colonized actors. But the scenario was much more complex. The fact that Luiz Felipe Thomas was the editor of the military bulletin A Província de Timor, where all of Abílio Araújo's criticisms of Jaime Neves and Inácio de Moura were published, suggests how frontiers of the colonial past were quite blurred. In this context, it is important to note that in the 1973 debate, it was Luiz Felipe Thomas who took a position against Moura's narratives about the Barlaki. Moreover, it is clear that Abílio Araújo, Nicolau Lobato, and Xavier do Amaral were quite assimilated, sharing most of their classificatory system with their Portuguese interlocutors. Thus, the controversy cannot be reduced to an opposition between colonizers and colonized. The challenges facing Istimorese women to get married for love was the primary political mover in the colonial criticism towards Rafoli or Balak. The material exchanges that would allow a marriage to take place were understood as a market operation that rendered women as commodities or even as slaves. These exchanges would respond only to the material interests of the bride's family members, with no respect for a woman's desires and expectations, eliminating a woman's free choice about whom to marry. In addition, it was contended that traditional marriage were one of the main causes of the submissive position assigned to women in the local societies. The customary marriage was thus seen as an affront to a woman's dignity because it would prevent them from acting as individuals and make their own choices. Opposing these perspectives, Abílio Araújo, at first, and later Nicolau Lobato, Xavier do Amaral, and Luiz Felipe Thomas argue that the material exchange that composed Barlack did not imply the respect for women's feeling and choice for marriage. Therefore, there was no opposition between Barlack and marriage for love. Concerns with the maintenance of status and ranking of lineage groups derived from the marriage tactics would be the main constraint on a woman's will in a marriage arrangement, according with Philip Thomas. In addition, the material exchanges which made up the Barlack wouldn't per se undermine the condition of women in society. Conversely, the larger the material exchanges between wife takers and wife givers, the greater the bride's sense of honor. In this perspective, the bride's sense of value and that of the families involved in the marriage would be directly related to the amount of goods exchanged. Jaime Neves and Inácio de Moura's accounts claimed an understanding of Barlack by what it consisted of at the time of the wedding, that is, an exchange of assets for taking a woman in marriage. Oriented by a sort of Western ontology in which things and persons are incommensurable, or in which a personal value cannot be converted into material items or monetary amounts, Neves and Moura see customary marriage as a moral outrage. The exchange of goods between wife-takers and wife-givers at the wedding is the fact that feeds most of Neves and Moura's perceptions about the customary marriage as a market exchange and supports their evaluation of it as an inappropriate and barbaric trait in people disrespectful of their feelings and emotions. There was a purification anxiety in Neves and Moura's accounts who, by all means, wanted to identify what, after all, the Barlack or Rapolin consisted of. They were searched for the essence, the core of the traditional marriage, attempted to make sense of it by itself without considering other factors. The Barlack must be one thing or another. It was inconceivable that it could have various meanings and functions simultaneously. From this approach, particular images of East Timorese indigenous people emerged that were devised to underpin civilizational projects. The animist character of indigenous religious practices are presented as the reason why they would place so much value on material exchanges for marriage proposals. They are also portrayed as materialistic and selfish people because they would place more value on the material dimension of a marriage than on people's feelings and desires. Local folk are also presented as the ones who trade people. These cultural features must be overcome by exposing people to civilizational process that the colonial endeavor should promote. Nevertheless, the indigenous peoples were qualified as good people who needed only to be Christianized to reveal all their positive potential. Opposing this purification anxiety were the narratives presented by Abílio Araújo, Nicolau Lobato, Xavier do Amaral and Luiz Felipe Thomas. In general, they proposed a more holistic approach to marriage, to customary marriage, trying to demonstrate its wider character as a central institution where various dimensions of local society were negotiated. In fact, they fostered a sort of anti-purification position in the debate. In their perspectives, the customary marriage was more of a matrix for negotiation of social life than a thing in itself. All these actors rejected an isolated understanding of the Barlack or Rapolin. In this context, there would be no opposition between material goods and persons in the making of the marriage. Conversely, the making of the persons, individual or collective persons, would be derived from material exchange. These perspectives produce another image of the East Timorese indigenous societies. First and foremost, they are depicted as complex and structured realities ruled by particular forms of organizations that are not understandable from an exclusively rational or Western grasp. They also suggest that women have a high status in the stimulated society, given the awareness that social and biological reproduction relied on them. This would be the reason why they would be called Fatima Romântica. Romantic love is also presented as a phenomenon of the local society to which people gave great attention for marriage proposals. The harmonizing effects of customary marriage are pointed out in its potential to include personal desires and interests. The offering of goods involved in the marriage exchanges are presented as a sign of deference to the woman and a source of pride for the families involved. It is asserted that the barlat is the most essential institution in the local society and that from which all other social dynamics are derived. In this perspective, the stimulus people are presented as virtues, comparable to the more civilized people because of the values they have and celebrated. In short, one notes that marriage practices in the late colonial context were kind of a generative thing that produced various images of the local people and their society. If you consider as a market operation, the indigenous people emerge as barbaric and insensitive, in urgent need of civilization. In the holistic perspective supported by Luis Felipe Thomas, Abel Araújo, among others, the local society is complex and evolved, yet difficult to understand by a Westerner who is emotionally unfamiliar with the local context. The position of the women in the local system of prestige is also another important discursive mobilizing in the debate and a sign of civilization for the actors. While the barlat and hapon make the condition of women very low in the local society, according to Neves and de Moura, Abel Araújo emphasized how local people saw women's fundamental role for social reproduction. Nevertheless, both the sides in the debate recognized that the marriage practices were in a process of change and advocated, in some cases, for stronger colonial control or even a Christianization of this institution. I'm going up for the discussion on epistemological practices. Despite the various positions held by different actors in the debate, all those involved were mobilized by what we might call an anxiety of knowledge towards the stimulus indigenous peoples. The local practices of social reproduction were often considered a mystery, secrets, or enigma that needed to be unveiled. In fact, Abel Araújo recalled in an interview I had with him that a guerra do barlat inspired a research endeavor for he and his colleagues. The misrepresentation of the barlat in the Moura's narratives led them to a journey of enlightenment and discovery about the local institution that ultimately triggered out a feeling of pre-nationalism. Independent of the positions held by people involved in the controversy, to legitimate their position, they resorted to very similar epistemological practices. All of them resorted to etymology, to colonial ethnographies, those conducted by missionaries and others, methodological arguments, and to comparisons to support their respective point of view. The word barlat came to be scrutinized by both parties in the debate. It was believed that its original meaning could unveil its current uses in estima. From this perspective, Abel Araújo proposed that the word came from the Malay words ber, joined with lak, which signified to get a husband. Since it signified the process of getting married from the woman's point of view, it was proposed that the barlat was not a market operation. Jaime Neves, in turn, based on Osório de Castro works, suggested that barlat would characterize both the process of a woman getting a husband or that of a man getting a wife. The usage and meaning of words like sosa, that is to buy, or holo, to acquire, and importantly, folha, value, were also explored in the debate. whatever the uses of the question, quali lira, or how much, in order to learn the monetary value of a good to be bought in the market environment, was explored by Jarnet to support his and the Moura's perspectives that the half-folly was a market operation. The use of the same word, folly, for either the marriage negotiation and for the market environment to denote expectations related to the kind or amount of assets and money to be offered in exchange for a good or for a woman in marriage was seen as a sign that the same regime of exchange, the market regime, framed both phenomena. On the other hand, Nicolau Lobach argued that it was a mistake to translate half-folly to give a value for Sosa to buy. He affirms that no dictionary offers this translation. He brought to the fore the fact that the Teton language had two different words to differentiate distinct ways to get access to particular things. Instead of saying that someone would Sosa Feto buy a woman, the only acceptable way to express to get a wife would be holofeto. The word Sosa would be used only for assets acquired by means of a market operation. By opposing this perspective, Jarnet emphasized that the everyday usage of a word or language did not necessarily respond to its normative meaning or syntax. Another very important resource used to support the contested perspectives on Warlach were the colonial ethnographies. The citation of missionary ethnographies or of colonial administrators' accounts is pervasive in the controversy. For instance, to oppose Abílio Araújo's arguments that the literal translation of Warlach is to get a husband, Jarnet quoted Osório de Castro. In the same article, the works of Fábio Laranjeiro, Jaime Ribeiro, Pinto Correia, Amy Forbes, and others are also quoted to support Neves' understanding of the marriage exchange as an obvious market operation. In response to this perspective and to mark a contrast with it, Araújo quoted Padre Ezequiel Pascoal's book, Alma de Timó Vista em Sua Fantasia, which points out the complexity of the marriage practice that could not be easily understood given the local authorities' reluctance to share their knowledge with foreign people. In this context, Araújo highlights what we call an ethnographic mistake found in Jarnet's narratives about the marriage exchange that would considerably weaken their persuasiveness. Neves asserts that the bride is exchanged for pigs. In response, Araújo stressed that pigs are an exclusive gift given by the bride's family to the groom's one. This basic mistake is seen by Araújo as an evidence of his opponent's fragile knowledge of the issue. Ethnographic accuracy was thus understood as being needed to strengthen the different positions in the debate. The fact that some missionary ethnographies attempted to make sense of marriage exchanges using words such as donation, dowry, or even gift to contrast it with the hegemonic colonial interpretation about the half-folly as a market operation compelled John Neves to speak out on the issue. According to Neves, certain missionary accounts would use such words or invest in these perspectives for benevolent reasons. To keep their moral commitment with these stimulus indigenous peoples, the missionaries would lie about the meanings of half-folly or Warlach as a non-market operation. In Neves' view, anyone who considered the customary marriage as something other than a market operation was engaging in sentimental fantasies. During the controversy in different moments, it is suggested that Abílio Araújo, Xavier do Amaral, Nicolau Lobato, or the missionaries fell into romanticism for not recognizing that the women were sold in the customary marriages. This romantic approach would prevent people from striving to emancipate local indigenous people from their ignorant practices. It would be necessary to abandon this passionate analysis to lead people to civilization. The alleged lack of accuracy of the missionary accounts about customary marriage asserted by Jaime Neves suggests that the controversy was shaped by an strategic reading of colonial knowledge. An affirmation was considered inaccurate the moment it challenged the effort at purification made by a body tumor or threatened the meta-narrative that affirmed that the marriage exchange was a market operation. The controversy was thus shaped by an ambiguous relationship with the colonial knowledge. Methodological arguments also framed the controversy. Broadly speaking, on one hand, Jamnev emulated the alleged skills of a Voz de Timor team in using what he considered the modern methods of anthropology and sociology. Authors like Durkheim, Murdoch, Hedgefield Brown, Malinowski, and even the Brazilian Thales de Azevedo were brought to the fore to show off how well-oriented, erudite, and up-to-date a Voz de Timor team was by engaging in the debate according to scientific criteria. The disagreement from their distinguished interlocutors, in turn, are attributed to their lack of proper methodological training. This inexperience led them to surrender to sentimental and literary arguments that would lack any scientific approach. The distinguished interlocutors are thus depicted as incipient folklorists. On the other hand, Abílio Araújo and Xavier do Amaral claimed that more than literary or academic knowledge was needed to truly understand the local institutions. An emotional closeness to the local world was required to comprehend these institutions. The absence of this intimacy would misguide people in their attempts to rationally understand the local practice. An example of this would be the mistakes made by Jaime Neves and Avoz Timor team. They had not observed the subtleties of the Teton language, which had particular words to qualify the exchanges framed by different regimes. It seems that this narrative was shaped by a sort of nativist ideology or claim that suggests that only people from East Timor could truly understand the local institutions or culture. It is not by chance, therefore, that this rationale is similar to the one that fosters nationalism as a political project and that this controversy is considered today as a critical event in the emergence of the East Timorese national awareness. As Michel Foucault often points out, knowledge and power are simply two faces of the same coin. I pass now for my conclusion. I will not discuss about comparison because I don't have time here, okay? It goes without saying that the biological tension to trigger controversy is not exclusive to the past. Current marriage practices indeed are strongly influenced by the contested character of these institutions that continues to produce opposing perspectives about local society. As I have demonstrated elsewhere, the current debate among the elite about the marriage prestations is also framed by attempts to inscribe the barlaki or folly into a regime of market or that of gift exchange, a phenomenon that is directly connected with the people's different trajectories of migration and interaction with the colonial powers established in Timor. The opposing understandings of the barlaki or hafoli indicate the differing perspectives about local society or about the local people. Broadly speaking, for those who consider the hafoli a market exchange, the local indigenous people are uncivilized, irrational, and materialistic group who have still not truly internalized that people and things pertain to different ontologies and cannot be exchanged one for another. Granted that the local indigenous people are turned once again into subjects of government practices. On the other hand, those who see the hafoli as a form of gift exchange have a more respectful perspective of the local people and their society. The barlaki is considered as a means for establishing rules for social reproduction and for demonstrating respect and consideration. In this view, the local indigenous people are seen as understanding how to foster dignity and an appropriate relation with ancestors and other supernatural agents. In addition, Hapolin is also seen as a way to honor people's multiple ritual obligations. Apparently, these distinct outlooks about the Hapolin would give origin to very diverse forms of marriage practices. During my fieldwork, some of my interlocutors anxiously pointed out that the marriage practice of their families did not involve Varlak because they had long been civilized people. However, as I have demonstrated in other papers, their marriage practices are very similar to those in which people openly requested the Varlak falling as a particular gift function. In fact, it is not heard that the amount of money or assets exchanged in marriage that are not supposed to involve the falling or Varlak as a particular gift function is higher than in those in which a Varlak explicitly occurs. Even so, people made a point of showing that they hadn't requested Varlak or falling in their marriage arrangements. I have risked proposing that this situation is the product of two intertwined colonial events. One of them is related with the remarkable role that the non-adherence to Varlak and to other usos e costumes had as a condition for assigning people the status of assimilado, the highest citizenship status available to local people in the Portuguese colonies until 1954. By denying their engagement in marriage practices mediated by Hapolin or Varlak, people emulate practices considered modern and civilized in both the colonial past as well in the contemporary deal. Another phenomenon that appears to be influenced this scenario is the colonial interpretations of the indigenous marriage practices in Istimo. Despite the various gift functions related to marriage, they have been rhetorically reduced to Varlak or Hapolin in certain colonial and post-colonial narratives. In this process, a Guerra do Varlak seems to have had a leading role. Such controversy plot appears to remain silent about the various moments of exchanges and of the distinct gift functions that compose the marriage process as a social technology of negotiating rights in persons. So, it's not by chance that it is the presence or absence of falling or Varlak that has marked the ways people have handled their marriage practices to produce identification effects in jail today. Thank you.